So I see that there's a lot of things going on behind you. What is it? There's books,
Not
there's
to portray any intellect and stuff, but if you look at how my house is laid out, that's the only view I have. And my wife sits opposite me, and she has the cupboards behind her, much like your view.
Yeah,
So,
not very
what?
intellectual.
No, I'm just saying, like, usually people say you've got that bookshelf behind to show how much you've read and stuff, but literally how the house is designed and furniture set up, this is my view,
Yeah.
and she sits, it's the cupboard view. So,
How many of these have you read actually? A lot,
these
I'm
I've read bulk
assuming.
of them. I mean, because many of them are about 12 years old. I think 7, 8 years, everything shifted onto the Kindle.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, I mean, like one shelf's most of it is football stuff, and then remaining, obviously, my wife's and her collection. So, but yeah, read through most of them, at least being sincere, and like made whatever little notes and post-its and
Yeah.
destroyed half of them with comments and things. So, highlighters and all sorts.
That's nice. I think I'm gonna be one of those people that at the end of it will be like, oh, I wish I read. I just didn't read enough, kids. Make sure you read. I think I'm gonna be that grandpa because I just don't read enough. I wish
Apply
I
that
did.
whole tech minimalism thing, right? Like just keep everything away and then do your best to go through books. I haven't been good with it for last 4 5 weeks, but went through a lot. As in, when you put your phone away and get everything away, you can get a lot accomplished. So
Yeah.
I've been
Are you
working
doing
that
that?
for last few years.
Are you doing that?
Tracking screen time, and I think half of the guys might complain also that I don't answer my phone and you get only one tick. So I put it on that Zen mode thing for about 4 hours per day, then 12 hours in the night. So you get 2 hours before sleep and after sleep, you can't access anything.
Yeah.
Yeah, those things have come really handy, especially when you're trying to read, and even like tons of restrictions on the laptop itself.
Yeah.
So you don't go into any rabbit holes and stuff where one article leads to 20 others, and
That's so
at the
true.
end of it, you don't know what you started off with. So yeah,
Yeah.
try and manage that.
Yeah, it's no good. Yeah. At the end of it just you feel guilty as well at the end of it. It's
Yeah,
a weird
the
guilt
guilt
that you
is.
can't. Yeah. It's a good thing to live by actually, because sometimes I do think that maybe making things so accessible that everything that we can do is on here and this is something that we can carry in our pockets just makes it's like distraction simplified and it's right in your pockets and it just doesn't
It's
help you
disturbing,
out.
right? Like they spend billions to get your attention. Like
Exactly.
there's a
What are
whole
you trying to
industry
hide?
dedicated to,
Yeah.
yeah. So best is to keep it away and
Yeah.
not even have it in the same room for most part of the day. So
Yeah, I'm working towards it. It's sometimes I win these battles, sometimes I don't. And right
no.
now I'm failing miserably. So,
What have you been doing though to keep busy and things? Last 1.5 years, you said.
yeah, I mean, a lot of work, a lot of
Yeah.
work. It's just our style of like whatever we did, our whole industry has just changed so drastically that
Yeah.
everything was about going out and shooting and taking cameras, and now it's all about doing Zoom calls and finding better ways to film remotely and things like that. It's just our whole outlook on how content can be made and can be delivered has completely changed. And it's like you can still talk, knock on wood, like we at least are in a position where our industry could take that B route, you know, we
Yeah.
could still keep doing what we were doing without taking a significant fall on our pay, and we weren't financially affected, which is not bad. So work has been great. Took a while. Earlier on, it was around 12 hours every day, just sitting in front of a screen, which did not help my head. But it's better now. I'm so used to it. It's just, yeah, part of the routine. I think it's
Yeah.
going to be weirder for me when I do go back in the brick and mortar office.
Yeah, back to
Although I'm looking
Bangalore
forward to
and
it. Yeah, although I'm kind of looking forward to it. Let's talk about Bangalore. Like the way we first met, our first introduction was when I was heading to the gym and you were coming back. I was telling Prad
No, I
about it.
heard that last night, in fact, that just going through that interview and things.
Okay.
So yeah, I mean, I recall that. Just
Yeah.
I think I shouted out and yeah, patted you and
Yeah.
told
And I was
Ryan, and
like,
he figured out.
I think you had your shades on or something. And I was like, Richard, you live in Indiranagar or what?
On 11th Main, so it's not too far away from that gym. And I think you live close by as well, right? Like it
Yeah, I
was
live in
about 10 minute
12th
walk, you
Main.
said, yeah.
Yeah, we're very close. Yeah. So you're on this side, I'm on this side of the gym. So it's, but it's,
Yeah,
I
neither
think
side
it's
of 100 feet road. Yeah.
exactly. Yeah.
I'm closer to,
Yeah.
yeah, 80 feet road. Yeah.
Not bad. You work out a lot, I'm assuming.
Now,
Keep yourself fit.
thankfully, I'm managing to do about 10 hours of spinning every week. So I do 2 hours per day into 5 days a week. Strength equipment is just the bands and kettlebells that are around.
Yeah.
But I've gotten back into it seriously for last 3 weeks now.
Yeah.
It was a big, there's no motivation, right, beyond a point. And I was cycling all the way from here to our center in Yalahanka. So that was about 60 kilometers of cycling per day when the season was on.
That's crazy.
So that was at least a good way of getting all the cardio bit out of the way and things. But yeah, like when the gym shut down last, to go to Gold's Gym further down the road.
Yeah.
So they're selling off all the equipment, so I picked up the spin bike from there. So
And did you get it at a
probably
good
the best.
price?
Yeah, like it's one of those Kaiser things, right? So I got for about a 20th of its price.
Wow.
And, yeah, I don't think the guys who were selling it had any idea about how pricey these things were. So they were
Wow.
selling like the really downgraded version and this for the exact same price. And these are like one of those minimalistic things, right? Like they don't have all those stickers and don't look gaudy and stuff. So I think these
Yeah.
guys thought that it should be down, whatever, bring the price down based purely on appearance. But yeah,
Yeah.
it was a good deal that I got for it.
Not bad at all. Yeah. It's weird that these deals never happen to me. Like I always hear stories about this, and I got that 20 to the price. And I'm like, where am I when things like these are happening?
Secondhand though,
Why
it wasn't like sparkling brand new or anything.
am I?
I'm sure like it's about 4 5 years old and
Gets it
stuff,
done
but
though.
yeah, a bargain's a bargain, so take it any day.
It's my whole not only work, I think my perspective on working out changed quite a lot as well, because I was one of those that, oh no, workouts only happen in the gym. Workouts, I need to go to the gym to make it happen. And I just have to, just have to adapt. So for the first time in my life, it's like I'm working out at gym. I gave yoga a try, which is, good Lord, that thing is hard. I wouldn't have imagined yoga is not easy, especially when as you progress, it's not easy.
My wife's like a
And
full-time instructor and things, but I've never really taken to
you
it.
should.
But
I'm trying to get a split. I'm trying to get a front split, and I'm in a place where it's, I can see it, but it's not quite there. And I know
it will
that
happen, I'm
last
sure.
phase is the longest one. It'll happen. It'll happen. But it's just that
This all happened
I'm
once you
trying
went back home?
to. What again?
Yoga and stuff happened once you went back to Chandigarh, or
Yeah,
you
yeah,
got
yeah,
into all
yeah.
this?
It's
Okay.
yeah. My mom got me into it, so my mom was really adamant about it. She's like, it's gonna change things. It's gonna help you. Because I was, she noticed how unflexible I was. I'd always be like, I have strength and things like that, but I would always never have spring in my step, and there was some flexibility issues here and there. Hamstrings always tight, and now just do a proper forward fold with my palms
Oh,
down and
nice.
things like that. It's crazy.
Okay. We believe in the
Helps, man.
process then.
Yeah,
Yeah.
you should get into it. You should get into it. I think
I'm happy
you
to get
literally have
into
got a
it.
trainer right next to you, so it's not even a
I think that's
problem.
what's what I think. It's too much proximity. So don't really, you take it for granted, right? Like it's always there when people fly down to whatever, get lessons. So
In Hindi we say "घर की मुर्गी दाल बराबर."
the barabar, yeah. That's
So
exactly
that's
it.
exactly what it is. That's exactly what it is. So you watched the game last night? Of
Yeah.
course you did.
So yeah, we went on to a pretty long call after that. We went on till about midnight with the
Yeah,
other guys, about five,
I
six guys
know.
jumping in and out. So yeah, it was fun
Yeah.
though. It's good that we got 3 points. At least builds up the Afghanistan game really well.
Yeah.
That'll be worth looking forward to now.
Yeah. It's just a draw that we need to end up third now, right? Because they're at 5 points, we're at six. So even if we get a draw against Bangladesh, we're
Does
still ending
Afghanistan
up
have
third.
one more game though? I think they're playing Oman,
Do
no?
they?
Yeah, I think so. Or this
Okay.
is it for them?
Gotta check.
Afghanistan, Qatar or something?
That's not good for us then. It's not even popping up for me. Anyway, if that's the case, then maybe it's just a a game we need to win.
Either which way, I think we set our hearts on that whole bit of getting 6 points right out of the last two games.
Yeah.
I mean, the target was quite clear going into this.
Well, that's our target. I don't know what the team's target is.
I think they've mentioned that as well. But
okay.
I think finishing third would be crucial when we get into the September playoffs, right, for the AFC Cup.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
AFC Asian Cup game.
They play these guys, Oman.
Oman, no? Afghanistan, that's
yeah.
When?
That's on the 11th, and then 4 days later, they play us. So
okay.
We've got rest, so I think, which is nice.
Yeah, that's a rest day, I think. Yeah, the other four are playing.
Yeah. That's not bad. What do you think of the game? I was, till the 75th minute, I felt like banging my head on the wall. I was like, what on earth are we doing? This is rinse and repeat with us. What were your thoughts?
I just thought, like, it's difficult to tell, right? Because you really don't know what the intent is. Like, yesterday was just really fresh in memory and things. So, you could at least speak about it quite clearly and stuff. But, like, overall, like, yeah. If not for the 2 goals, what would our verdict be about it? Because you obviously, I mean, as objective as we try and be, like, the whole emotion of it, you get tied into it. A big relief when the first goal went in, and then the second goal was what it was.
Cherry
but yeah
top.
I mean yeah but reasons for concerns are obviously there, because what can we expect against Afghanistan now, who are infinitely better than Bangladesh? I mean, it was the exact same game, Afghanistan versus Bangladesh and India versus Bangladesh, if you stack up the stats and things, similar attacking pattern, similar attempts at goal. So it tells you a thing or two that you know, Afghanistan wasn't really clinical against these guys, and they paid a price for it. India, thankfully, when it countered those last two chances that fell at Chetri's feet, head and feet, we could convert it, right? So, but I mean, it's just that in longer term, where does this all sort of add up and build up? Because we're talking about our very two last games. If you look at the map, right, on Wikipedia for the World Cup qualifications, so all the countries that have been eliminated so far are marked out in yellow in that world map, and it's just India and about 4 or 5 other countries. So we are like amongst the first to get eliminated in whatever this 2022 World Cup qualifiers, like goes phase by phase. Obviously, by next match day, number of yellow nations will increase significantly. But I think right after the Qatar game, we were up there with just like about 6-7 countries. So like those sort of graphics also start to like hit you that, I mean, we were first in this race, then backwards in terms of being eliminated. But can't really say redemption and stuff, right? Because even tactically, there wasn't much to sort of read into, you know, though it was a 3-5-2 and try as you did to score and things, because it's that bit, right? Like Qatar did the exact same thing against Bangladesh, what they did against us, but they scored 5 goals, but Bangladesh didn't have a good pre. Playing for them, right? So similar stuff, right? Like from the 6-yard box straight into Gurpreet's hands, those saves of the feet and things. And Bangladesh conceded 5, doing the exact same thing we did, like park the bus slow and get about 10 bodies behind the ball and things. So similar with us. I mean, like this whole game is defined on those finishing touches. Can change the whole script and interpretation of it. So
that's not true.
Yeah, so I mean, like just picking up from what we last saw, then yeah, I mean, Afghanistan is such a different team, man, like, compared to Bangladesh. You have these guys who 6-7 of them play outside of Afghanistan, across Europe and across, I mean, one of them plays in India.
Yeah.
So, and plus, technically, they look really, really good. So that's all we're looking at. If Bangladesh, if everybody thought that's a team we have to beat and really test where we are, I think, a opposition like Afghanistan based on what we've seen now, because somebody had commented a few days back that the game that we played against Afghanistan away, it was on turf at the stadium at Dushanbe. So usually you hear these guys complain that it's a totally different game on turf and natural grass. So like looking at Afghanistan with what they did against Bangladesh, the tempo of the passes, the just the general technical qualities we could see. It was far more tidy than whatever little I recall of that game against us that we played in Dushanbe. So it'll be interesting though. 15th game should be fun. Let's see.
Yeah.
What about
Oh,
you? What did you
with.
make of it?
Oh, I mean, my opinions don't matter as much as yours, obviously,
They
but
do,
like,
man.
I mean, come on. Let's be honest here. But I think it's just. I felt like if those two goals didn't go in, it would have been a completely different reaction. Like, it's a complete 180 we take on the reaction. Like, all the positivity we have in media right now, it wouldn't have been the case because. This game, no matter what happens, at the end of the day, the results do matter. You know, the missing of the chances and playing passes that don't really matter, doing 1-2s when we should be direct a little more. All of that, great. Doesn't matter if the scoreline ends up being a nil-nil. And yeah, that's why I was one of the few people who would always try to get behind the manager, the Constantine, because. I know, because these same players will not be able to play the football that you kind of expect them to. And props to him for trying. I'll say that. Props to him for the two concerns that we had with Stamats. Number one, we wanted him to give chances to players that we actually think deserve them. And number two, we wanted India to play better football. That on the grand scheme of things, these were the two things that Indian football fans wanted. He's trying to give them that. And AIFF has clearly told him that these are the objectives that we have for the football team in the future as well. And he's in many ways putting his neck on the line because I think even he realizes that I can't always be playing like it. And with Qatar, you could see that because Qatar was more like Constantine and less like Igor Stamats, you know, because he has that pragmatism in him as well. But then he's trying, obviously, but you can see that his players are just not capable enough to play those 1-2s because. The 1-2 happens, but the third is just cleared every single time. It was the story of the first half, and it was very frustrating for me.
Especially when we chuck
Yeah.
two up there playing off the center backs, those combinations. With
Yeah.
Brandon playing as deep as he did compared to where Sunil and Manvir were, maybe where Sunil and
Yeah.
Manvir were parallel, right? Like they were next to each
Yeah.
other.
That doesn't make sense
Even
to
where
me.
does the ball go
Yeah.
afterwards? Yeah. So
Yeah.
one of them should have left the line. Who knows? I mean, it's easy to talk in hindsight. I can
Obviously.
explain everything once it's
Yeah.
over. So
Yeah. I want to get your thoughts on this actually, because I have been saying this before every game that Sunil should not be playing as a marksman. You know, he shouldn't be the guy up top. He doesn't have the physicality for it. He's got too many good qualities to be playing in that position because you can exploit that guy a little more if you play him deeper. Don't you think that should be the case for him? Like, shouldn't he be the number 10? Shouldn't he be in the midfield? And we should have someone else up front, take more advantage of his qualities.
I think his best utility comes in inside the box, right? So
That's true.
whether he plays a bit deeper and things, if he's the one picking it up, spraying it out wide and then getting into the penalty spot and 6 yard box area, between that space to connect and things, that's where his strengths are. Or even on cutbacks, he's great because if ball's coming backwards, he's walking into
Exactly.
the box at the time. So I think as a person who, because he's if there's a cross, he's great at losing his markers. I mean, the movement that we saw for the first goal, you could 100% tell, but that was also largely due to the left back as well expecting somebody to be there, right? So Chhetri
Yeah.
stops his run, goes in, comes away from the line because these guys are drilled into that. Drop
Yeah.
in together, drop back together, and then the defense midfielders don't really cover for them either. So it wasn't like it was a free header or anything. Keeper didn't really cover his angles too well, but that's Chhetri, right? So he's
Yeah.
going to get those sort of chances with that narrower option to convert bottom corner and things that were the opposite post while drifting away. Like all those skills put together, it was a great goal. I mean, falling this
Yeah.
way and then hitting it and things. So,
Of course.
but yeah, I mean, like if he plays deeper or not, I think his skills count only in the final third. And how do we get him there? And how do we get the ball to him for him to connect with. That's the main puzzle I think the coaching staff will be looking at fulfilling because even in midfield, it matters little because he will, as the ball's coming to the box, he will find his way. Like that's his territory, right? Where to move, figures out space. I think he scored against Iran also a few years back. He scored against Oman and things. And the previous, I mean, yeah, Oman and Iran in the previous qualifying rounds. And you could tell that, I mean, his presence and things is. Much needed at the top. So even if you give him a free role, if he's instrumental in picking the ball up from midfield and ensuring those passes are connected, for the like people underestimate his passing ability as well, like those weighted passes into sprinting wingers' feet and things. I mean, the sort of pass appreciation that his teammates want from him, like playing the pass that your teammates expect, that understanding is great. So, like I said, that can't really designate him as an out-and-out striker playing up top and things, because then, yeah, like you said, it would be wasting him, because if you try and go over these guys or through them, maybe that pace and things. But again, man, like these guys, they try and figure against Bangladesh, he looked great, and against Afghanistan, again, it'd be a good test, because those two center backs really sorted the Afghans. Will be
That's
interesting
true.
how they employ Sunil over there.
Yeah, that's for sure. I think that the amount of possession and how open they were to us having the ball, it won't be the case against Afghanistan, surely. It won't be like you'll get these opportunities over and over again. And when you do get these opportunities, you want to convert them, because Bangladesh felt like, okay, hit us with as much as you can, and maybe one of them will creep in.
And they're
And that's
comfortable with
exactly
that.
what
I mean,
happened.
it's not like because I think there was a goal line save, right, of Sana's header.
What I said, that when Chinglinson headed the balls and Bangla balls cleared them off. That's exactly what happened.
But like these guys are used to doing that, though. I mean, like I think the previous game also there were a couple of mistakes, and I mean, like sitting and watching, obviously you start to think that, man, that's really going to rattle the confidence seeing the teammate do make that level of a mistake and thing. But then you realize that, okay, these guys are get over these things really quickly. I mean, shot on target from the 6-yard box and nobody's really rattled and things. So like it's in terms of
Drill
what's
into
coming
them.
their way and maybe their recovery, psychological recovery from one frantic moment to another is quite rapid. But that's because they've invited trouble so many times, as in I think they're prepared to deal with it and things. But that's what I found in terms of if at all we had seen similar reactions with our team, like they really get stuck into each other and sort of questions being asked and stuff. But these guys are like okay, let's move on. But I think there was a crappy clearance as well. This guy should have let the ball go out, but he took it down and then tried to bring it back into play yesterday. And yeah, like I mean, just the sort of reactions you expect for something like that just wasn't there. So I guess it was. But yeah, I mean, like it will be a better test against Afghanistan for sure, just in terms of what we were used to. बहुत मार खाया भाई, मतलब शुरू से ही.
And how much flack I got for it, because I remember when I did a preview video for the first qualifier, the one before this one, the first leg, and I was like, this is surely going to be a win. Bangladesh is in a footballing nation. This, that. I trashed them all over the place. And then, of course, it happened. It was about a 1-1, was it? Or a
One one,
0-0?
yeah. One
1-1,
one.
yeah.
Adil
And
scored,
then
right? So
that video went to 76,000 views. And guess what? Majority of the views came from Bangladesh, all of them slating
trashing
me.
you.
And the words, thank God I don't know. Thank God I don't know Bengali.
Bangla.
Otherwise, my
It was
confidence
not a
would be
question. I
shot.
mean, like even if you look at that game again, just for purely from the stats point of view, it was just that we didn't convert. I mean, we're paying the price of not producing strikers and players who know where the goal is. So I think
So true.
you 70% possession, and I think we had more than double digits in terms of chances created. But yeah, I mean, like you said earlier, like if those two goals hadn't gone in, the reactions and mood and stuff would have been really different, and it wasn't much different from the game over there. I mean, obviously Bangladesh had 5-6 really dangerous attacks in that game. I mean, they broke us down a lot more. But then again, it was Adil and Anas, I think, who were playing the at centre back. And even for that matter, Bangladesh had their guy who traditionally plays centre forward playing at centre back for them in the Calcutta leg, right? So I mean, I think both teams had wholesale changes. Bangladesh, I think only two guys who played in Calcutta featured again. And I think for us, we had, at least if you look at the starting 11 again, it was a very small number. I think Sunil, Gurpreet, Brandon, I think like just about three or four guys. So there were 14 new faces on the pitch between both the teams.
Substitutions counted in.
No, even the starting 11, if you take from the previous game. Just that it was 14 new, and with substitution, it goes up to around 17, 18, I guess, guys who didn't feature in that game at all and came on. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, but it's changed quite a bit. I mean, it's not But yeah, that game was a bit more end to end, the Calcutta leg. But this was totally one side. I don't think Gurpreet had much to do for most of the game. So,
yeah, barely
and
anything.
plus, you have to also like take into account it's a 90 minute game, man. So, even if you win it in the 88th and 90 plus minute and things, it
A
doesn't
win's a
matter.
win.
Win is a win. Yeah. So, counted, I guess. We sealed the game, and yeah, I think 20 days from now, nobody's going to talk about it.
That's so true.
Memories are so short, so
Yeah, I can't ever recall how we won the game. I just remember we won it, you know, like it's, I can't keep all that in
story
my
behind
head.
it.
Yeah, the story behind it can fuck itself, to be honest. Forget all that. We won it. That is it. Wikipedia says 2-0, so that is it. what's your thoughts on the starting 11 changing constantly, and obviously how much Stimac changed his team, because he's still relatively a new manager, given that with the 1 year absence due to COVID-19, you still have had what not too many games, and how drastically his starting 11 has changed, and his flexibility is a compliment to be paid to the manager, or do you think it's just the fact that the players that did appear were not consistent enough? Where do you think the credit lies?
I don't know about credit, because again, the dynamics of team selections have changed so far, so quickly. I mean, like after the chat we had at 420 grams yesterday, I think all of us got a bit too involved with this whole talk of we don't know the starting 11 at all. When Mangi and Ranidi, at least I was speaking of the fan yesterday, saying that when these guys were playing, I could name the entire bench even. Like even before the game started, or team sheets and stuff were out, because that whole era, you could, I mean, you would follow domestic football. You knew what was coming your way. The guys who performed, you could even foresee the 28 probables, 38 probables and things, because you knew the national team coach in and out. But I think right now, this whole exchange of information, like whole society has become like really horizontal now, right? Like tomorrow, people can tag Steve Match on a post questioning why MT selected X, Y, and Z, why didn't you pay attention to him? And they can reach out to different people within the squad, and they can reach out to players themselves. So in terms of the voice reaching, I don't think Bob Huftin even once would have heard from a fan that, or Constantine for that matter, in his first stint, all these things from the general public reaching them in such a clear way, like people making their own starting 11s and things like that, guys like you coming in, having these channels and following and stuff. So in terms of communicating, the voice of the masses has sort of amplified, as in you're just one click away from understanding what are 30,000 fans thinking, what is the team of the week, what is the team of the month, team of the season, all these things, right? So based on that, if, like you said, maybe this whole 1 year gap that Steve Match had thanks to the lockdown and COVID situation, maybe that started to play a lot on it as well, because one is to follow the game. I think he was away from the whole bubble and things, so he is following it from distance. Venky would have been around following most of the teams and things, and if nothing, these things find a way to you. I mean, there's no way of escaping it. People telling him that why don't you look at this player, he's a rising star and all of that. And maybe I said it's not a question of credit, but then what exactly is a national team player now? As in, on what profiles and on what competencies are you selecting them? Because back then, I'm just talking from Houghton's era and things, like you knew exactly this is the football that we're going to see. This is what the wingers are going to do. This is what the strikers have to do. This is what the midfielders are going to do, where the ball's going to go, all those things, right? So whether you're playing for your club or you're being called into the national team camp, this level of clarity was there throughout. That this is what we can expect, and they weren't trying to do too much. I think if we're talking about pragmatic, realistic, whatever word we want to attach to choices that coaches employ to their tactics, at the end of the day, I think national team is a very sacred sort of platform for people to come into, and not saying anybody deserves it or doesn't deserve it, because at the end of the day, Steve Match, by giving each kid a debut, is sticking out his neck for them, saying that they deserve this.
Cool.
And when I make them step in, they will perform. But eventually, but that's a part of the contract, right? If you put your pen to paper, then you're agreeing to all the criticism, guys like you and me discussing it and things. So that's part of his job as well, that if XYZ amount of people get their debuts, and as fans, we don't really recognize the 11. But results, again, like we can't really expect more against Qatar. Oman has only been improving through the years. Afghanistan has got a whole bunch of overseas players, overseas based players coming in and playing for them. So strategically, I mean, I can't forget about this game or steam match and things like that, but like even future of Indian football based on, let's say, 15 to 20 years from now, there's a source of our talents and things. I mean, like, what's the national team going to look like? What are the choices going to be based on? So that's a major question over that. As fans, what exactly is it that we can pin down on and understand? So, what Srimash does is suited to his ideals, his understanding of the game, his expectations. I guess he's based it on that. So, I guess pull the mic, I mean, the lens out, you zoom out and things, and then you have to base it on the metrics and win percentages and all of that. Because even if you have 70% possession and you don't win, then I think that's where the people who have to take a call will take a call.
True. That is true. Oh. What's your thoughts on, and we'll come to PIOs and OCIs as well. I think the fact that we're playing against a team that possesses them, I think it's going to kind of heighten the conversation with you talking about the horizontal and everything. I think it kind of, it's not like the coach is always anyway looking for excuses to talk about it. You know, we've seen that every time he's asked a question about OCI, PIO players, he's not the one to back down. He is open and he clearly wants it. We'll talk about that in a bit as well. But in terms of just a clear style of play, obviously very difficult for you to decipher as well, given how limited we've seen this iteration of the Indian football team. And it feels weird to say it because an iteration for the Indian football team usually used to back in the day and ended up lasting for 10 years. This one keeps on changing every 6 months. But this iteration of it, 3-5-2, finally a game where we took the game to the opposition. Do you think this is the ideal formation for the team, given that the wing backs are almost always unreliable?
I mean, it's not really so much formation or taking the game to them. I think we had figured out that one, that Bangladesh denied space centrally and even deeper into the half. So it's better to get more numbers in there. Just having Udanta and Bipin on the wings would do the job. But I mean, but that's also dependent on quality services coming into the box, right? I mean, it's not just about keeping those boys there, but once the ball goes there, what happens next? Ideal style of play and things, I think the national, the federation has to stick to one sort of commit to one sort of plan and things, because I think Pradyum mentioned Lakshya, I have a copy of it here. And funnily enough, next year will be its 10-year anniversary. Right. And that's a 10-year plan right there. I think that we would come closer than ever to qualify for the 2022 World Cup. That whole document there, that's what the
what
whole
a good time to like. Resurface it.
I'm planning a really long, I mean, I've gone off Twitter completely, but like the 2-3 threads that I've already started working on that 10 years since Lakshya, how many technical directors have we had? What's the state of the league? What was promised over there? What are we doing now? So just in those terms, I have started to script this entire thing. Because that Lakshya thing, I was really kicked about it. Like when it first came out and stuff, I was like, finally, and I was like complete... into the sold on this Dutch model. And honestly, myself, I've changed that whole approach to what's correct in terms of youth development multiple times. It isn't that the way of thinking that has come in now, or how I've interpreted the game and India's development pathway has been the same. So when this whole Lakshya thing came, I was like, at that time, it was sort of like, this is great, the whole Dutch model and things. But like if you just look at it from the point of view, when Lakshya came out, let's say 10 years ago, all these guys who are playing now, Dheeraj, Suresh, all these guys are 10 years old then, right? So back then, did this plan touch on how we should be developing them? I mean, like, take all the 20-year-olds now. Liston, you take Yasser, you take both the fullbacks for Hyderabad FC and things. Have those ideals and things trickle down to them when they were 10. This I'm talking in the year 2012.
Yeah.
Right. So, I mean, just the legacy of the document stating that, okay, this is the pathway forward. It's a strategic plan and it had a style of play written down over there, or at least a necessity to have something defined. But I think more than that, this whole thing of future plan, I don't even know how I got onto Lakshya and things, but it's just that we really don't have footballing ideals either. I mean, just in terms of understanding benchmarks and stuff, even that knowledge really doesn't exist in the country. So even if you say playing out from the back, but just in terms of this engagement, quality of engagement, interpreting quality and things, because every drop of a hat, Academy opens, Indian team for the World Cup 2028 or 2026 and whatnot. And in fact, I've got this whole file of where I've compiled every guy's prediction of when we'll qualify for the World Cup. So from Sachin Tendulkar saying we'll do it in 6 years' time to Abhishek Bachchan to Dino Moria to John Abraham to who else was it? I think whatever. I mean, like if any non-footballing guys, because some guy comes from the NBA, they ask him, when do you think India will qualify for the World Cup? Ronaldinho visits, Paul Scholes visits, Zidane comes in here to inaugurate some construction thing, or some Argentine footballer comes to Kerala for a jewelry shop inaugural. That question gets asked and they tell you, no, we definitely believe that India is on the right path and whatnot. And then this gets, so I've got this whole directory of bits, and I'm just wondering, man, like if, how is that possibly the only be all and end all? I mean, like if somebody who can maybe give you some meaningful insights and stuff, that's one question you never really spare anybody coming into the country with some sort of reputation. So, I mean, we are looking for reinforcements, or let's just say reasons to believe, based on these guys who spend 48 hours in the country or spend a week in the country and go away. Like Crespo had come down for the under-17 World Cup. When do you think the senior team will qualify? I think it will happen in no time, and then he goes away. But just the sheer amount of work that goes into it, I mean, like it's much beyond the document. I mean, like I'm just saying that had we stuck to that in terms of having a style of play, I think that's where the question started off. If the 10-year-olds back then and who are 20-year-old today, at least if they get developed within a certain pathway, certain ideals, certain understanding of what qualities required, I think we would have had a much better generation of players today. And it's never too late. I mean, like I keep saying it's your 4, 5, 6 year olds are the future. I mean, you try and invest anything beyond that, you're just sort of pushing the development or indicators maybe like 5% in terms of the progress that we've made. If you get this whole generation really triggered at the right age, because neurologically or whatever it is, I mean, the window shuts. I try as much as you might. You bring down any coach and things, but the problem solving skills in the head and execution skills in the on the feet, that circuit gets closed up between the ages of 13 and 14. And you need to do a bulk of your development before that. And I don't mean having these heavily prescribed curriculums or A-licensed coaches down there and things, but the amount of football our kids experience is nowhere close to even ideating on a style of play, because you're always going to be restricted by the quality of your players. Like if you are, if 3-5-2 is justified, it's justified, right? Because you have three guys who can cover those spaces in case you decide to chuck seven up to add numbers and support the attacking play and things, well and good. You can play a 4-3-3 also by sending both the fullbacks up and asking the defensive midfielder to stay back. Whatever it is, I mean, the way you want to occupy the pitch and occupy spaces, that's one thing. But at the end of it, the end product, right? Like, there will be teams. I mean, I'm sure when we play again in September, based on the quality of teams we'll face over there, there will be more teams who will be happy to sort of concede possession to us. I mean, I don't think that will happen, but it's too tough to tell, man. Like what formation and what style of play and things, because at the end of the day, you're as good as your toolkit, right? I mean, or toolbox. I mean, you can't repair a car with scissors and threads and needle and things. That's all that you've got. So if there's a problem to be solved, you need to have all those right sort of assets and skills to call on. And that's, I mean, you look at Persepolis play, I'm sure you watched the AFC Champions League. Not a single foreign player on the pitch, other than that goalkeeper who played that second game against FC Goa. He had just one game, the Croatian goalkeeper. Not a single foreigner on the bench either from the staff. It's all Iran, like including the... and I think only 4 guys from Persepolis are there in the Iran national team. Remaining guys. So this is like the leftover of the guys who are not playing in Europe.
That's crazy.
Was there... And you see the quality over there, man. It was night and day. And what's Iran's model then? What have they built up all these technical qualities on? Where is their document, or where is their Lakshya, whatever it is? I mean, you keep talking about them being war-ridden and whatnot. You start to mean, why are we looking at Europe so much, and why not keep an eye on Iran and things?
That's not
Because,
true.
and it's a very, very elite pool, right? Like this whole World Cup, because I went on a rant about all these guys who said we'll qualify, but to displace these guys is going to take decades. I mean, like once you figure it out how to qualify, like Japan's figured it out, they're going to qualify every time now. There's not much they need to do in terms of the system. Everything is in place. The players are being produced. The league is great. They're exporting all of that. They're importing quality guys in the league. I mean, compared to China and stuff, it is less of the whole hype and things. Korea is doing the same thing. And one thing people miss about Korea is they have the least number of foreign coaches after Iran. They won the Champions League the maximum number of times. They won the AFC Under-19s the maximum number of times. And the difference is about 20 times. I think Korea has won it around 21 times, and the next best team has won it 7 times or something like that. So the domination at the Asian level, like people keep going on and on about Japan and the other teams, but like South Korea in the youth circuit, especially this under 19, under 23, and they have the most number of successful clubs winning titles at the AFC Champions League, won by Korean coaches. So if you're looking at in terms of this whole thing of let's import and let's bring these guys in, fantastic. I'm like, these guys are adding value and stuff. 100% we need to bring them in. But at the end of it, this whole Indian assistant system, it's like learning how to swim on YouTube in my house, on my couch. I mean, like, unless you're thrown into the pool, into the deep end and things, you're not really going to learn. And this whole thing of we'll develop a quality is without the whole emotional burden of it, without the whole pressure side of things. It's a very different. So, I mean, like, you look at the holistic development of these countries. I mean, we really don't talk as much as we should be talking about them. When you talk about academies, the direct reference goes into English EPPP academies, or into the Belgian model, into the Portuguese model, into the Spanish model, or the French model and things. People aren't really paying closer attention to these guys. And where is Korea's document then? Where is Japan's document? In terms of, let's say, what about Saudi Arabia now? They've also been in and about. If you look at the hierarchy, there are three teams who are in this, in terms of guaranteed to qualify, more or less, Iran, Japan, and Korea. Then the fourth and fifth team are either are Saudi Arabia's and three, four of these other guys. So even the gap within Asia from these elite four, five teams to the rest of them is massive. I mean, people don't understand that. So it would be a lot more prudent to understand, like, seeing the forest for the trees, right? Because most of our guys, we go and visit these top academies and things, and then we figure out, oh, we need infrastructure is a big problem. We need more coaches in this country and all of that. But it's difficult for us to fathom the amount of engagement that is taking place. I mean, your under 12 league in the Catalan district goes into 16 different groups and 18 teams in each group. Do the maths. I'm just talking about the under 12. Then you have under
Not
13,
very
then you
good at it,
have.
but that's around what, 200 teams,
Sorry.
250, 300 teams.
Something like that. So
That's
it's
crazy.
anything above 100 is decent, I think. So I think that whole engagement is just not there to even sort of conceptualize 3-5-2, 4-1-4-1, whatever it is, because football is an education, as in. You speak to most of these guys who have played at the highest level and things. They've been taught those positions to such a degree. I think there's a really old tweet of mine about Pavel Nedved's program when he was 12. So this whole thing of foreign tours and stuff, I'd done it when I was 17, 18. Like before anybody else had done it as a player, I thought like I'm the next best thing in Indian football. So I'd managed to get myself to Czech Republic for about 4 months, Denmark for about 6 months, and Australia for about 6 months when I was 17 and 18. Don't ask how or why I wrote all these emails and these guys accepted me. So, and this was all based on me being school team captain. It wasn't like I've done much and I told these guys that I'm going to become. I mean, the level of delusion I had back then, so at least my growing up was really rapid in terms of. I think these guys just
Realization, the reality hit quick.
really quick. So by 19, I think I understood that how far behind we are. But there's this thing that I've shared, right? Like Pavel Nedved's one full page thing when he was 11 years old by his coach. I mean, he had coached me as well. And that was a parting gift he gave me, like framed and things. This is what done for him. You're talking about his left foot being weaker. His jumping strength from his right foot is not as strong as his left. His headers need to be worked on 20 times every Tuesday and whatever. I mean, those details are there both in Czech and in English translated. And so Pavel Nedved would be whatever 40 something now. So we're talking about player individual development plans going into like early 80s is what I'm talking, mid 80s and things. So this I'm talking about 30 years ago, they were breaking down player skills and position based programs to such a degree 30 years ago, which is why a small country. And when I'd gone there, they were number two team in the world. I'd gone there in 2015. Sorry, 2005. Sorry. So they were ranked
not
number,
15, obviously. Yeah,
not 15. So so they were ranked two in the world and things. And Bonner there, I mean, even in those details, we're pretty far behind. So if you're talking about this whole style of play, like we need a whole first is the masses, and then second thing is just the dedication and understanding of what it takes to produce world-class players. I mean, the process is so intense that, I mean, like anybody gets a world-class tag over here. I think overnight, if you score a bicycle kick or something, world-class goal and things, I mean, it's easy to hype things up. But, I mean, if you boil things down, make it black and white and things, then those gaps become really, again, that Persepolis game, even though it was the 1-0, but speed at which with which these guys were passing the ball, the ability to take people on, none of our guys were considered rapid and quick in the ISL, disturbing these guys or even getting them to breathe heavy for a second and things. So that, I mean, you will get many of these examples. I think further on, we keep exposing ourselves to the Champions League level, at least the knowledge will come back to us, and we'll understand, okay, that's probably world class, right? Like that's the quality of players that we see. So without this quality-obsessed approach to developing players, the style of play is never going to come in. I mean, like you can ideate on it, man. Like we want to do build out from the back. We want progressive progression into the box. We want quick 1-2s. Not with three in the front, just the one. We want two wingers. Whatever it is, we'll just see three at the back. Ideating about it and then actually putting in a decade and a half worth of work behind it to develop these skills. I think that's where the work is, like today's 5, 6, 7 year olds. Firstly, building up the whole technical repertoire, getting them comfortable with the ball, you know, the physicality and things. And then at 14, 15, 16, you can start fitting them into systems and whatnot. And yeah, so it's a long process, man. Like even to fathom what style of player, what formation, come away, ideating about it, what is ideal for what is happening now, I think it's best left to the coach. But if the federation or let's just say the game community or stakeholders are serious about it, I think that's where the commitment and investments need to be directed into a 15 to 20 year from now pathway, as opposed to 2026 World Cup. What are we going to do about it? Because we can't go around in a 4-year cycle all the time. We need to commit to a 20-year cycle at least. Like three
so
World
true.
Cups from now or something.
Yeah. Long answer. I mean, long answer, but it actually made a lot of sense, because the conversation essentially started with me asking you a question about, like, is this how we'll keep playing? But like the long answer is actually the true answer, because you could have given me a nice sugar-coated answer about, yeah, I think we showed some positive signs here. I think it's about building, you know. I can construct an answer for you. I'm no football expert, but I can construct that sugar-coated answer, which you could have given me. But I think you gave the right answer, because we can't build an Eiffel Tower with Lego bricks. It just doesn't happen, right? And I think that's exactly what it is. I don't know how much at liberty you are when it comes to answering this. But when you talk about just this media messaging and things like that, and how hellbent, not just people, I don't blame the people, but just the federation and things like that are in terms of just putting the bigger message out there that we are going to change football, we're going to win the World Cup. This is what Zidane said, this is what Ronaldinho said, this and that. The people who actually work and the governing body of the game in this country, do you think they understand football at the level, and are there people who are decision makers who understand football and Asian football at a level that you do and can give answers like that? Are arguments like that actually being made, or is it still about putting on a facade saying that India will go on and play in the 2026 World Cup?
I mean, like, credit to them, including our GS and things, like, as long the 3 years that I spent over there, I've done at least, I think, gone on stage at least, I think, upwards of 20, 25 times, given that there is one presentation that I've got that lays all this bare in terms of all these MOUs that we've signed, in terms of all these stats about not dominating at the youth level, all these tours and where we finished in these youth tournaments, finished last in every tournament and things. And I've delivered one in his presence, and there never really has been a gag order, including being able to speak my mind when there was this FICCI convention also, FICCI convention in 2019 and things, where all these guys were present. So not once have they come up. And even for me, it was a very conscious decision that I never wanted to be on the back foot for my opinion. So whether it was a tweet or whether it was anything that I put out there or whether it was a slide or a statement, everything was backed up by numbers and evidence. There wasn't one thing where they said, my opinion is getting ahead of me. Maybe I'm thinking way ahead of my experience or way ahead of my background or my, let's just say, because everything. I mean, like right
Got
from,
yeah.
I think if you go through the entire handle and things or whatever I put out, or even when I speak on any of these interactions and stuff, I make it a point that I know what I'm talking about is researched. And if anybody questions me, the most I'll back up is, here's the evidence, have a look for yourself. And not, I take back what I said, I was wrong. So that way, and also, I mean, like, I think people get the whole federation wrong. I mean, it'll sound like I'm defending them. I have my share of criticism about them and things.
No,
but
I'm
it's
sure
not
you won't
their
defend
job
them.
To... I mean, just the way you look at the other federations, the way they run and things, it's not as centralized as it is in India. I mean, like in the amount of, I don't know, man, like the amount of connections that they try to make directly to the Delhi office and things, the amount, because if we have to develop, a lot of things have to be done in an autonomous way, and not everything has to make its way into social media. Not everything needs a pat on the back or a ribbon cut or a chief guest or an important person, eminent personality coming in and gracing the occasion and things, because that's what we are after more 9 out of 10 times.
Exactly. That's
So the simple things that need to be done to develop a game that will take the game forward. First question that comes, I'm talking from the game community point of view or the stakeholders, what's in it for us? Why 10 years? Why not 5 years? Will the federation give us a certificate? Will we get a letter from the GS or president acknowledging? Will we get where will we get media coverage and things like that? And I'm talking about simple things like put together a league for 8-10 year olds, right? I mean, like, for something as simple as that, it's the adult who wants this whole credit, this whole credit mongering system. So and minute they see that that's not coming their way, then the interest starts to wane. Then you know they're not in it for the right reasons. So minute we start to break through the noise, right? Like, is this really the federation's problem? So federation, in terms of, let's just take the technical department, the technical directors, pillars of what he needs to take care of. One is your grassroots, that is everything informal, right from your beach football, futsal, women's football, all of it. Anything that is non-professional, non-elite is grassroots, not this eight or whatever, below 12 years old. Any informal form of football is grassroots. That can be completely decentralized. So your TAL leagues in Bangalore, all that is happening, all me going and playing in TN2 every Tuesday and Thursday, that's grassroots football taking place. Or these kids in Austin Town or those kids in Calcutta just playing, putting two stones and creating goals out of them, that's still grassroots. So does the federation need to have their eye on that and dedicate any effort to it while it's happening organically? No. Then the next pillar of it is your elite football. So you have grassroots and then you have elite youth development. Who's responsible for that primarily? It's your best academies and it's your clubs. And maybe in many cases, these independent bodies like your state FA doing a little bit extra to develop the talent and things. So how much of a influence does the national, does the federation need to have in that? None. Other than the licensing, but telling you that, okay, this is the framework. You need to comply by this. You haven't met these requirements. Please look into it. Right. So again, there the attention should be going to them. If you decided to open an academy, 365 days of the year, maybe like two of those days, you might have some interaction with the federation. So what are you doing with the remaining 363 days? Then you come to the next pillar of national teams. That's their domain. But where does that get filled in from? Your clubs and academies again, right? From your junior teams to your senior national teams. And then I think the last pillar is coach education in terms of coach development and things, which again, we've got autonomy now. We've got the whole convention and things under our belt. And courses are happening. We have an instructor. So in terms of this whole scope of attention, do these guys understand football or not, X, Y, and Z? At the bare grassroots level or at the base level, the really local level, is there enough happening before the... I mean, the guys pointing fingers. I mean, if you look left and right, up and down, do you see enough happening to say that we need the push from top to take this forward? What's happening really for you to raise your concern over there? And the Federation should only be looking at these four things. I mean, like, even the media and stuff. Now, if Zidane has come and said we'll qualify for the 2023, why won't they hype it up? Right. I mean, like, in today's social media world also, if I say two words, one of those words is going to offend somebody. There's no two combination of words that won't offend anybody. And I'm just talking
for
about,
sure.
So even if I rattle on with 10 words, that increases my chances of people not agreeing with me and not seeing eye to eye. So I don't think, I used to be very anti whatever approach they had back then and then till very recently. But then you start to study how national federations work around the world and what sort of decisions and things that are being taken. They're distracted half the time. I mean, like with this whole circuit that is going on. So a lot of the bulk of it stays with the community, it stays with the state federations and things. And if you have to understand it, it's your all of these four things coming together that reflects in your national team. If your grassroots is good, then your elite football will obviously be good. If your elite football is good, it'll feed good professionals into the senior team. And this will all be enabled by good coaches that are being that are handling and overlooking this entire program. And again, it's never going to boil down to this whole 3-4 year program that we keep coming up with. Like we have gone through at least 4-year plans or 4-5 year plans or whichever you want to look at it about next World Cup, we'll do this. I mean, One Academy in Bengal, they've changed that sign. I mean, aim to qualify for World Cup. It started off with 2006. Then they rubbed it off. They put 2010. They rubbed it off. They put 2014. And that photo is there. I mean, like because they do that ceremony all the time.
Yeah.
So that target has shifted by 4 years. After each World Cup gets done, they shifted it forward. Right. So, I mean, you're placing all these hopes and things and whatnot.
Yeah.
But coming to it, forget about this media narrative and whatnot. But what are we a footballing nation? I mean, those are a few questions that we really need to ask. Just in terms of sheer engagement, where exactly do you see it? Like, where is the engagement? And engagement, I'm talking about these kids being a part of their life from the age of 4, 5, and 6. And even if it's a handful of kids, no problem. But where are we seeing this meaningful upbringing with the game? Where it's interweaved with the schools and all of that. Like, if football replicates cricket, if you're an elite cricketer, you look at their circuit, man. Like, it's mind-bogglingly busy. Those kids are training hard and things. And trust me, there's no tougher national team in the world than to get into the Indian national team.
Yeah.
Whether you name the Brazilian football team or the New Zealand All Blacks or whatever it is, the Indian cricket team is the toughest elite sports team to get into. Like, it's incredibly tough. So you have this entire system working underneath it, understands what world class is, understands what it really takes, because there's so many stories scattered across the country. Now you take Sunil Chhetri's example, how are you going to recreate his development pathway? You need to find two people who, one dad who's in the army and a mom who played for a national team to come in. You need to recreate all those dinner conversations that he talks about when they used to discuss the game and things. You need to give him a multi-sport upbringing where till his early teens and things, he was playing different sports till he narrowed down on football. You need to make sure that he consciously didn't go to a football academy, that he played a lot of matches. So how do you recreate? And which is where I keep saying that these... this whole federation versus national scenario and things. Messi's career, you can track from the age of 4. Signed up for Grandoli, Newell's Old Boys to Barcelona. Aguero's career, you can track from the age of 3. Because he had a jersey with a badge that is identifiable and that pathway followed. God knows, a big part that his dad also used to play and whatnot. But all I'm saying is, where is that pathway in the country now? Before we start pointing a finger upwards that do these guys actually understand football or not? Because these guys... Federation's job is to streamline everything, put it into a system that meaningfully feeds your league and things like that. So I think, because I think this is probably, I have a huge bias towards the 20-year plan as opposed to whatever it is that ISL should lengthen itself and whatnot. Even if it does, like, what benefit is it going to give you? Chuck out all the foreigners from the league. What immediate results are you going to see? Are we going to produce strikers overnight and things? But have the strikers receive the same amount of attention in their development education from coaches who know how to develop a striker before they come into that pathway? And this engagement thing that I keep talking about, because everything compounds, right? Like, if you talk about, I think Pradyum mentioned that again, it again sort of favors the federation, that why aren't the states taking up this whole thing of conducting the youth leagues?
Yeah.
Right. So let's just say the average 12-year-old kid in Japan and the average 12-year-old kid in India, the Japanese kid is playing 40 matches per year. By his 20th matches from the age of 12 to 20, whatever, I think 40 into 8, 100, how much is that? 320 matches.
320, yeah. You won.
320 matches, yeah. And then India could get 10, 12 matches at best at a decent level.
No.
So when you calculate all of that, 40 matches, 80 matches versus 320 matches, who's going to have the better motor skills? Who's going to know how to play that? And if he's got those 320 matches, you know, 250 of those are in his preferred position.
True.
So Chetri's goal yesterday was the result of 20 years of experience coming together in that one moment, right?
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
Even so, I mean, if you're building up an armory of kids who have that experience in their bank when they step onto the pitch, doing the making the right decisions, executing in the right sort of way, that has to come off the back of a 20-year pathway of, I think, intense this thing, right? Engagement. I mean, these kids have to engage meaningfully. And I'm talking about five-a-sides where it's necessary, seven-a-sides where it's necessary, play on those mud pitches and things, because again, that infrastructure issue comes up that India is really lacking in infrastructure and whatnot. But people don't highlight the Ghana coach's comments. When he came to India and played against us in the Under-17 World Cup, he said, "You guys have got such good facilities. Had we had this in Ghana, we would have really advanced." So, I mean, like, what are we going on about that team that qualifies for the World Cup, produces world-class players, gets into the Premier League and French leagues and whatnot. Their Under-17 World Cup coach comes and leaves with this comment that, "I wish we had this back in our country." So,
yeah.
In terms of perspective, are we using, I mean, are we optimally using what we already have in place? And then point a finger to the federation. You're not building enough pitches. You're not using your FIFA funds properly. But what are we doing to bring people into the game? I mean, like, even in terms of money and things. I mean, before we point, I mean, blame upwards, I think these questions need to. So they'll do that narration thing, man. I mean, why not? And I will criticize, like, on WhatsApp group, what's said between friends and things, that will always persist. I mean, what we discuss. Obviously, we don't buy into it, right? Like, knowing it is what it is. But those tweets and those messages are not for you and me. It's for the fans.
Exactly.
Who believe and want the best for the national team, who are not bothered with whether who our technical director is, who have no idea who the next youth player is and things. I mean, if you're a national team fan, you're not bothered with that one. So you want to hear...
Exactly.
Good messaging and things, right? So they're doing their job, and we can criticize all we want, but you and me and other whatever who fall into this bracket will be about 20 outnumbered by 1,000. So it's not saying it's pointless, but it's I mean, it's
best. But it is pointless. I get it. So well, who does state FA answer to then? Like, if is there no accountability there? Because you need impetus. You need someone to answer to, some advantage that you get out of
that's
doing
a,
something.
It becomes a legal battle, I think. I think Rohit Ramesh has recently challenged the Tamil Nadu Association. See, like, there are no benchmarks as such right now that you need to conduct so many games. Or let's just say region-specific models. So if Mizoram has got a population of about 2 million and Bombay's got a population of about 24 million, what we expect Bombay to pull off in terms of engaging numbers and bringing people in, and what we expect Mizoram to do, these two things, they are miles apart. But Mizoram is significantly more productive in terms of producing players. So the idea right now is to figure out what can we do to bring out the best in Mizoram, what can we do to bring out the best in West Bengal. Because even the best right now is not world-class by any standards. It might be excellent for India. These guys are absolutely killing it at the youth levels and things, showcasing these great skills and stuff. And then we start to get into this talk about, let's send them abroad. But legally, it's not possible to do that till their 18th birthday now. I think these whole FIFA restrictions and things that have come into place, you can't... get them abroad and engage them meaningfully over there, unless you transfer the entire family, which again is a big racket right now with underage kids being imported by clubs along with their families. But yeah, I mean, like, state affairs, I think that's where I guess this whole understanding of world-class needs to really kick in. What does a good 77 game between 8-year-olds look like? And if somebody can direct that, somebody can keep infusing that match day to match day. That you walk in on the first week of January, you have your state or let's say Bangalore technical director, Bombay technical director or technical advisor, whatever it may be. And he goes and gives these things that can be carried on match day to match day. That is from Saturday to Saturday for 40 Saturdays of each year. And then you compare the picture, like record it even, what the under-8 tournament looked like on in the first week of Jan and then the last week of October. I think that's where you'll start to see significant changes. But if you keep having these 4-5 week long tournaments where it's 10 matches and then that's it for the entire year, you're not giving these kids, nor are the state associations shouldering enough responsibility. We talk about money and things, you just see the way Mizoram organizes the youth sector. There's a jersey right here, I can show it to you later. But an under 12 jersey with around 6 sponsors, DB Medical Store, MP Shoe Store, David's Bakery, Zote's Kitchen. And this guy pays 5,000 bucks a month. This guy pays 2,000 bucks a month. This guy pays 2,000 bucks a month. This guy pays 3,000 rupees a month. But that's enough to cover your coach's wages. He comes in only 3 times a week and trains them. Covers the ground rentals. Each of the kids get boots and they get to keep the jersey.
Beautiful. And I love that.
All these 6 stores are within the, it's like Indranagar. So I'll go to 6 Got stores it, yeah. over here.
It's Mizoram after all. Yeah,
so, I mean, that's the humility there because they have the courage to actually go up there and say, can you give me 3,000 bucks a month? Can you give me 5,000? And then these are the possibilities that you guys can get. And that's where we really need to get it down to, and this you see all over the world. I mean, even if you go and see Ajax Youth and you see Feyenoord Rotterdam or even England and things, those under-8 tournaments, the number of sponsors that are there on these kids' jerseys, number of normal people coming forward to support it. So, I think there's a big gap between the gaming community and these bodies that operate them. Guys are sitting there with money, they don't know what to do with it. Federation is there with all the authority, but don't want to go out asking for people to come in. And so I think that's where, if that match happens and you tell them that, okay, you chuck in so much money, you change the life of 200 kids, let's say, we're running this league for so long and things. And and there's so many layers that you can bring into it because it is engagement at the end of the day. Like even your best academies, be it BSC or Reliance or whatever it is, if you're looking at from the time they pass out or even Tata Football Academy, you're going to produce one player out of every 100 who's going to be engaged in the game 5 years after he's finished with you all at the highest level.
Yeah.
So it is a 1 in 200 chance, more or less, that you see through 3-4 batches before you develop that player who's going to serve you for the next 5 to 8 years. In a meaningful way at the highest level. So all those investments and things, they're doing their job. But only thing that can better is if this whole circuit below that, like below the under 13 level, we start to amplify the amount of football these kids play and not necessarily keep scores and do it under floodlights and whatever, turf pitches and whatnot. Just do it wherever it's possible. So I think all the nakran stuff, if you start to remove it and then... see football development for what it is, like
it's not very glamorous.
Like Japan's backbone is school football, Korea's backbone is school football. There's no academy football per se and things. So what's stopping us from doing that? Like all these Jesuit institutes all across, get them together. Like the Bombay the Bombay school circuit has got some amount of football being played, but how can we amplify that now? Since from 10 matches, how do we increase the season to 30 matches for these kids? And parents don't feel that their academic life is under danger and things by getting them to play more. Because cricket seems to be coping with it quite well with their extensive calendars and stuff. So I think that's why we need to make it a lot more organic and long drawn.
So with Mizoram, obviously, like for them, the impetus is obviously coming from the local people who happen to love football. In a state like Uttar Pradesh, in a state like, name any state that doesn't really like football as much as they like cricket, you'll always have a situation where people don't want to invest the money if you're talking about local sponsors. And even if you're talking about people who run the state FA, there's not much happening there, obviously, because if situations like Rohit Ramesh writing to the IFF for de-recognition of the Tamil Nadu FA, if stuff like that is happening in a state like Tamil Nadu, which is actually known for producing footballers, what can you expect from an Uttar Pradesh or Rajasthan? So who are they answerable to? Because obviously Rohit has now written to the AIFF. So I'm assuming that the AIFF has to now look into it. But what can the AIFF do about it? Will they actually go on?
That's what I'm saying. There is no framework, right, to legitimize your existence as a football body. That to comply with it and things. So if you look at, I think AFC grants or something like that, or the FIFA grants, the money is only given if you conduct so many matches per year, or to get a certain status, you need to have certain amount of activity taking place. So let's just say that for the ISL to continue being a Champions League featuring team, they need to play 27 matches minimum, if not the upcoming season. And that's there in the document. So if your league is not long enough, not producing enough matches per team, then you can't compete. So by that way, having a... Yeah, from next season onwards. Yeah. So on that front, if you have this bare minimum guidelines or baseline and things that these guys need to be... But that again will be subject to votes, because AFF is a democratic body. It's a body made... AFF is a body made up of state bodies. So it's the bottom that dictates the top. So, I mean, how many feathers are you going to ruffle, and what exactly will be the outcome of this whole court hearing? It's, I mean, it's not for us to say anything, but at least somebody's taken notice and wants the Federation to do something about it. But your question about this whole thing of Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, all these places, right now we don't have the luxury of diversifying. I mean, like whatever resources we've got. And I'm not saying that chuck in all the money into your Bengals and Mizoram and things, but we need to understand where exactly should our priorities be. Where is the next best player going to come from? Where are the next, where is the next generation of Indian players going to come from? And from what sort of systems, which are producing, and what can we do to make it better? So the guys who are already ahead in the race and things, if they need new shoes, if they need new whatever aerodynamic clothing, or whatever sort of race it is that will make them faster, stronger, and get to the finish line a bit quicker, whatever our aims might be. I don't know the timelines and things. But to dilute your attention, to dilute your already limited resources in terms of trying to reignite places that are not as active or bought into, I mean, getting back to life and things in terms of UP players coming in or not. What can you do about it? I mean, like, suggestions wise, are we going to ban those FAs? What's going to happen in terms of
that? So it's essentially like it's not wrong to say that it is in many ways a flawed system, because if you're talking about ruffling feathers, you can't do it without ruffling feathers, right? And if you're scared about ruffling feathers, then you're literally back to square one. So in many ways,
I think the other way, other approach might be good in terms of creating a reward system. I think last year the AFF had a bunch of recognitions given out, the most productive state association, and that rattled a few people. I think Mizoram finished, I don't know the rankings, but Karnataka had come into the top five. Mizoram was there in the top five. They had various ratings and things. So if you can't, if it's not the stick, then it's a carrot. Then you really need to say which is the most productive. So this is where the hype comes in now. Like what we were talking about earlier, this whole media hype and whatnot. It gets under our skin and things, the times when we know it's not the truth and stuff and whatnot. But nothing better than patting the back of people publicly and really showcasing them as better than the rest in terms of saying this state is the best in youth development. Nobody does it better than them. This state runs the finest football league. Nobody does it better than them. And that's where people... I think ego is a good thing in these terms. I mean, there's no way... How can you... what's the punishment for running a 10-day league? Let's just say some state FA does it. They run a league and wrap it up within 10 days. What do we punish them with? They'll increase it by 2 days then. But the minute the benchmark and thing for acknowledgement becomes, okay, these guys have run the league for 4 months, Mizo League or Calcutta League, Bangalore League for that matter, it gets expansive. It has more professional teams coming in. So I think the carrot system would really work, and use all your media power and outreach and press releases and all that. Have an awards night, bring these guys in, fly them down, all of that. And, I mean, like I was with the AFC as well on the grassroots panel for the 3 years that I was with the AFF. So we used to get into Kuala Lumpur quite a few times just for these committee meetings and whatnot. And over there, they would have this happen. So you'll wonder why this guy from Bhutan is there. Best green program and whatnot. And then next year, massive feature in the AFC website that gets picked up by the FIFA website and things. And but that works though, because then people start to see what is it that I can do to get recognition.
Fair enough.
And then you put other people to task, like make sure next year I'm in the top three. And that's when you really, that is if you're concerned, if you're not bothered about
that's,
it.
That's what I was about to say. Exactly.
But I'm saying, yeah, but it will have a positive effect. If you're, let's just say you take your top five and make it a race between top five about who finishes first.
That's still better.
That's still better because the guy who's finishing fifth will start to put in the effort of what it takes to finish first. So you get a level playing field, and then it just becomes a question of quality and who does a bit more and things like that. But at least acknowledgement of these positive bits of development, no matter how minimal and stuff it may be, it will trigger a better benchmark. When people start to recognize this is good and this is sort of desirable, that's what starts to come in. Because again, man, like if you look at this whole development system, our best players, there's no way of tracking how do you produce an exam vision in terms of just the, let's just say the event-based pathway.
Yeah.
Like he started here and this happened, he went to this club. Up to his 18th birthday, nothing. Savio Madeira, Derek Pereira, I think all the TFA boys are sorted. They walked in there at the age of 13, 14, 15 and that's where they sort of picked up from. But there's so many players who developed outside of TFA.
Mm.
And how do you recreate Eugene's growth in the game? You need to have been born in Shillong, come for your hostel years to Bangalore and Bishop Cottons, be a part of that. I mean, there's so many abstract stories that make their way to the top. And there's no youth sort of bit. But all these developed countries and things have got this pathway sorted out, man. Like you can, your Korean national team, you can track this guy's growth in the game from the age of 4, 5 and 6. And similar, I think Iran will be as informal as India. But then again, you look at the whole grassroots structure in the other sense, they're great at futsal. They beat Brazil in the last Futsal World Cup in the quarterfinals, Iran.
Wow.
You speak to guys who've been to Tehran and things, they'll tell you that your drive to the airport, even at 3 a.m., you'll go across hundreds of these floodlit futsal courts and every one of them is occupied.
Wow.
Just
no wonder.
Drive to the Tehran airport and things. So they're engaging a lot more. I mean, there might not be a coach over there. There's no A-license guy over there. There's no Nike ball or whatever it is, but these guys are interacting with the game and building all these cues and whatever. I mean, like these game experiences that will come handy once they get onto the right sort of pathway and things. And that's where the Northeastern states probably outshine, because they have the least number of turf pitches in India. They have the least number of qualified coaches per population, that is per million or whatever it is if you take. In terms of all those development, quantifiable development benchmarks, these guys are probably the least progressive over there. But in terms of how productive they are with those bad pitches, with those minimal resources, with those untrained coaches, but highly, I mean, like if we talk about game wisdom, then there's a lot there in these Northeastern circles because the culture is really strong in terms of bringing the kids into the game a bit earlier and making sure that they stay engaged in things. And obviously, maybe distractions are lower. So,
That's true as well. Yeah, that's a factor. So, obviously, I like how we seamlessly transitioned from talking about the India versus Bangladesh game to talk about youth development. And that can only happen with a few people, and you're one of them. So, I appreciate that. If you had a magic wand and you could fix three things, what would those three things be to put us on the right path? If you're not already on it, which we clearly aren't, according to you, right?
Not according to me. I think you'll find plenty more joining the chorus, but I think one bit is the age at which we start and how long do we keep them engaged throughout the year. The amount of football that our kids should be experiencing in a meaningful way. I'm not necessarily talking about the amount of coaching that they get, but just informal engagement, formal engagement, game engagement at high pace, with good people guiding them, with good, meaningful people around those places to see and inspire them, get the best out of them. So that's starting at a real far earlier age. And then obviously the amount of, let's say, the volume of engagement going in a lot more. Second thing is ultra, ultra, hyper local systems coming in. That is your each district league pulling off, let's say, a 30, 35 game season right down to two or three divisions, engaging at least upwards of 45 teams. 15 teams per league or 20, 20, 20, 10, whatever it is, but at least you have 60 teams engaged in a 30 plus game season for at least 10 months of the year across all the districts, all the productive districts that we spoke about, not all of them. And then obviously this should be reflected at the top as well. Like if you're playing 30, 35 games at the local level, then your senior most league plus your cup tournaments in India should give best professionals a 55 game season at least. Your league plus your, let's say we revive the Fed Cup, if we revive the Durand and IFA Shield and make it meaningful enough for the best teams to come in and compete. Having that circuit revived again from, let's say, the elite youth point of view. And then third bit, I'm not sure, man, but just this whole thing of figuring out a 20-year pathway and sticking to it for the previous two things to make sense and have some sort of aspirational direction to go into. So I think, yeah, so maybe point number three feats, point number two and one.
Two and one, yeah.
I think, yeah, those few things. Then I think everything falls into place because your education, your the way your parents perceive the game and things, all of that. If you have the whole family invested in the game and stuff, and you don't need a lot. I mean, population, I think over here is a bit of a drawback. This whole 1 billion population, and I think you were talking about the PIO and OCI. The population of the other countries that we see deploying them is minuscule, like not even the population of Bombay at times. Countries that are successful with it. And if you look at Percy Polis or even the other team, Estegal, they had just three foreigners on the pitch. All of that. So I think it solves a lot of problems that, like, just having that 20-year, because then you're not really rattled and stuff. And then again, if you're talking about the whole media hype and getting the message out, the whole country should know we are on a 20-year pathway. Like, if any questions get raised, and then you can point, okay, we are in year 8 of 20 years to go, 12 more years to go. This is where we plan to be, and this is where we are right now. And you see so many countries being able to point to something that was agreed upon a few years ago, and then that success builds. And also the technical director, again, I mean, it's a 15-year appointment. We've had about 5-6 of them in the last 10 years. If you look at Savio stepping down and them now taking up again. So it's been a musical chair of sorts, obviously. But I think, yeah, it's a 15-year commitment to have the one guy who can stand against the criticism in the face of the storm and things and see it out and keep his finger on top of everything. Just those four things, like I told you, the your grassroots, your elite youth development, national teams and coach education, just these four things. That's your job description for the technical director. That's all that he has to overlook. There's nothing else. He doesn't interfere with the league. He doesn't interfere with the other aspects of it. Just these four things. And then you... yeah, but I think we need a leader as well in that aspect to come in and give that sort of time.
There's so much. There's so much. And it's just... I think what I always gauge when I get in conversations like these, like with you or with Brad, like whoever it is, like it's always about how frustrated you guys might get sometimes because you know so much and you want to make those changes, but sometimes you feel handcuffed in many ways because there's so much to do and there's not many people hearing you. There's not a lot of voices being heard.
And it doesn't matter also because we can't possibly have the ego to get frustrated by this, knowing what we know and whatnot, because in the sort of, again, like in the world we live in now, this will be forgotten in like 5 days. Whatever is being said over here, it's like whatever.
Yeah.
It fades away as quickly as it comes. So no. That's true. I just guess our frustrations should be as... durable as people's memories. If they remember long enough, then we should be frustrated. But if people move on quickly, then I don't think there is any scope for frustration as such. Which is, I mean, like even the whole decision to get into senior football coaching was largely that this is something we can like lock in all our attention, all our focus, bring in all our energy into it. And it's been far more rewarding, at least in terms of having these, facing up to the challenge of working in senior team football, because it's all immediate now. You're not worried that, man, if only these guys understood it took 20 years and whatnot. I mean, you're not dealing with that anymore. And it's about the next match day. It's about getting through right now. So in terms of a headspace and things, though people say you age a lot more at the senior level and things. But
it's actually been better for you because it's short-term goals. Yeah.
And yeah, it's a good thrill. I mean, great buzz to have all the time. Just working in that sort of space, right? So,
that's good. Will you ever consider going back to the IFF in a full-time role?
I don't think they'd want me back much because for all the noise and things that I made internally, as well as I think half of them would do that each time I'd stepped onto the stage to give those talks and stuff. I really don't know. I mean, like in terms of if you're talking about do these guys understand football and things like that, it's damn difficult, man. Like having worked there for 3 years, it's not that these guys don't understand what's happening, but then you're
Too blind to
dealing
see
with
it.
different mindsets. I mean,
Yeah.
well, the Federation have to understand cannot leave too many people upset either. So even if it's a simple thing of changing the age group for a particular tournament from 1 year to the next, you will get inundated with at least like 50, 60 emails from really influential people telling you that whatever, people fly down and then question them and think that you really don't know what you're doing and stuff. So it's not easy to work over there. I mean, like in terms of, I mean, be brave over there and things, because everything has to be calculated to such an extent. So most of the time there is some sort of a deliberate silence from their end for a lot of things. Not that they don't know or whatever it may be, but it's not that they aren't sure, man. Like if you look at what's happening in Singapore, if you look at what's happening in Malaysia, all of these, I think today morning I shared a couple of screenshots with Pradyum telling them that this is what Singapore has done over the last 3 years to change their entire league setup. This is what Malaysia did 10 years ago. They're discussing the whole senior league structure in India, where exactly whatever usual nonsense every day, where whatever, if only sort of talks that we keep having. But in the midst of that, even if I shared with some of the colleagues at AFF and things, the guys who work in various departments, they're quite well-read. They're very aware of what's going on and stuff. But how much can you do? Like I said, unless you have this whole armory of local support and activity and engagement working behind you to take these decisions forward, and then you would end up losing a lot more than you gain by being firm and upfront and things.
True.
And it's a little bit about me going back there. I really don't know in what capacity or where I would be useful. It was fun working on the youth program because at least got to develop the whole baby league concept and get people to buy into that. And secondly, working closely with Savio on the whole coach education side of things. That was a big, I mean, really gratifying part of the job. And of course, the interactions that you end up making, because you get to meet guys like Tete and Mizoram. You get to travel to all parts of the country and just go and talk to people, get them to understand them things. So, so that way, it's a great job. But I really wouldn't know why they would want me back. So,
It's what they say about politics as well, you know, sometimes, because you kind of need to get your hands dirty if you want to make the change. And I think it's one of those where I think people like you, people like Pratt, people and people around you as well, who truly understand the game and what the intricacies of it are, and what our culture is, and where the change truly needs to be made. And people like that need to be in the system, need to get their hands dirty. And while I understand that for you to breathe, to have them breathe down your neck and for them to be super critical is not very good for you and not very good for your mind as well. And I've been in positions as well where your ideas, when they're put down, it can get incredibly frustrating.
No, they've all accepted. Surprisingly, it wasn't that ideas were put down. I mean, proposed the baby league, got unanimous support at whatever. Back then, we flew down all these extra, all the India legends and stuff, and everybody gave the support and they put good weight behind it and things. So, whatever ideas that I had proposed and in coach education were completely taken on board. I had a good relationship with the league committees in terms of reforming the youth formats and whatnot. Again, great buy-in over there, because I think as long as you give reasons, right? Like, this is what is happening, this is why it should be done. And you can, again, like I think facts, evidence and numbers, you start working with that, at least your credibility is not really in question. Only the possibility of the plan working or not. They're really outright dismissed. I found the biggest obstacles at the state FA level. But obviously, the AFF will approve it. I mean, why won't they? Because they are not the people who are going to execute it. So, I mean, that's the other dynamic people need to understand. If AFF signs off on something, they're signing off on a concept. But the concept's execution is with the stakeholders, and not necessarily the state FAs. But who's the guy who's going to come and run a 10-month-long baby league for 8 different age groups for next 5 years? So that we don't lose a generation and whatnot. Who's going to come forward? So, like, in terms of idea, I think that's where I was maybe creating these great images in my head. Okay, great. It's been signed off. It's approved. And nobody opposes it. But I think it's more like, okay, now that you've got it, Show us examples of where it's being
Yeah.
executed now. Show us these
Yeah.
10 baby leagues across the country of 1 billion where kids are engaging. So I think that way, conceptually, I think we should be a lot more aware. Possibly I could have been a lot more realistic, but then knowing the gap, that the gap between us and the rest of the world starts at the ages of 4, 5, and 6. To plug that, that's the only solution. Then you start where they start.
Yeah.
Now, if the average Japanese kid is introduced to the game at the ages of 3 and 4, by the time he's 10 and our kid is learning a push pass or is first introduced to a football after watching his elder brother play cricket all the time, and then you think that, okay, at the age of 14, we'll send him abroad for 3 years.
And magically change them.
Happen because, I mean, as much as we keep talking about our guys, they should be playing abroad and things, right? Like our national team players and all of that. Oh, they should go abroad. They belong over there. Watch all the other groups in the AFC Champions League. You tell me if you find better players or not in their positions. Where you're saying, this guy, I can't believe he doesn't go abroad in XYZ country and play. But switch on your TV and all the matches are there. It's not like you get highlights, but you put whatever, hashtag AFC, ACL 2021 full replay. YouTube has every match over there. And you watch the, especially the Iran team, because that's all... That's my Dusri team and whatever that hashtag that came out the last World Cup, Meri Dusri team after Argentina, it was Iran. So like I pay really, really close attention to the league and very curious about them. But where are our, I mean, like if you look at, let's just say in terms of how many teams are there across Asia. So Japan, let's say 16 teams, Korea, 16 teams. There are 45 teams in Asia. So if you take 10 teams per professional level, that's 400 spots. Out of the 400 spots, there's one Asian, that AFC 3+1 rule. Each top league has got that one Asian spot to be filled. So there are about 400 spots to be filled. Which Indian is going and filling that spot up? So in a lower ranked country, that's your substandard Japanese, it's a substandard Jordanian, it's a substandard Syrian, it's a substandard player from Thailand and stuff who goes and fills that up. Right? And then the top spots, obviously, all are boys from. Africa and Europe and South America and the Caribbean and things who fill up those 400 spots. And it's way more than 400, in fact. I'm just taking it 10 on average for 45 countries, but even if you increase it by 15 or make it 20 teams per league or whatever it may be. So there's no Indian featuring in that AFC plus one, whatever, 3+1 rule across all these nations. And then we're talking about Europe. You know, across the top tier in various Asian countries, nobody is really coming into our league and scouting these boys. But man, if we had this guy in a team for that Asian spot, but some guy who is playing third division in Japan is better than, obviously financially as well, because the valuation of an Indian player per unit of skill or talent is significantly higher than what a Japanese player
so
would cost.
Absolutely.
So the valuation part of it, I think that's where we miss out as well. I mean, how many of these guys are going to go play in Kyrgyzstan or Turkmenistan or something like that, becoming a plus one player? But you see so many, I mean, that being filled up by Australians, that being filled up by Japanese, Koreans, all over the Asian market. So I think that should be the first aspiration.
True. But when you do look at the national team right now, how many do you actually see in terms of the players that can play their trade at a higher level in Asia?
So there's a blog that I wrote about 10 years back and I mentioned Brandon quite specifically, thinking, and even that, I think that time he had gone to that thing in South Africa. I was in Goa for coaching at Vasco and at the time, and I'd seen him play because our Vasco under 18 teams got thumped by Salgaonkar's under 16 team, and Brandon was in the under 14 team.
Yeah.
So 13-year-old Brandon played against our under 18 Vasco team, and this guy scored a couple of goals in that game. So, and he was great. Like at the age of 13, he was absolutely incredible in terms of just the technical quality and stuff. It was so rare. So, and even now, I think, like in terms of ball at his feet, out of most of the players, in terms of technical quality, that would be our biggest trump card or person who stands out. So.
So that's one.
But it's one, but it's like, it's really, really complex because you look at the whole physical element here. Even I'll get some water, 1 second.
Yeah, take it. I need to charge. This chat will be oh absolutely useless if
We didn't record it.
no, I'm recording. Because I'm at 9% right now, and Macs have a thing where they approach 5%, they just go. So they'll keep you under the illusion. Oh God. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Brandon was one.
I'll reverse that question though, actually, because I mean, like, turn it back around. You look at where are the foreign players coming from, like within the country now, the last club, at what level have they been coming in from? The guys who are the highest paid foreigners and things, I think, barring Roy Krishna and stuff, and then we twist it around, right? Because
Yeah.
now you have to look at it from two points of view that okay, Roy Krishna is coming from I think
Really,
Wellington Phoenix,
Wellington, yeah.
right? So he was a foreign so to be a foreign player, the conditions are that you need to be better than any player available locally. Otherwise, what's the point of bringing in a foreigner? And then you need to be better than any foreigner available in the market for that particular budget. Otherwise, what's the point of flying you down there?
Fair enough.
So if you start to look at from that perspective, then if Brandon has to be exported or Ashik has to be exported or whoever it is that needs to be exported, and you're restricted by a number. So Gurpreet obviously will have his options in Asia completely cut down for them to commit to a goalkeeper, because I think 9 out of 10 teams would decide that okay, we need a centre back, central midfielder, centre forward, or whatever it may be. And so leaving Gurpreet out of it, then outfield player, I mean, we just need to think about it backwards. Which league is Brandon going to go into where he's going to be better than any of the local players and any of the foreign players who are available in the market for the price that he
Fill
expects?
that plus one position. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So, and then I don't have enough knowledge of what that plus one's standards are. Is it Katsumi Yusa? Is he better than Brandon? Is it Amiri, who plays for Real Kashmir? Is he better than Brandon? Just obviously completely different position and things. So let's work backwards from all the Asians that are floating around in the Indian game. You get Eric Parthaloo. You get who else is there? You can start naming them quite.
Yeah, I lost you, I lost you, I lost you.
Yeah, I think it should be on now. You see me now?
Nope, I can see your profile picture, which we need to talk about.
Yeah, I think it should be there now. Yeah.
Yeah, now I can see you.
Yeah. So, I mean, like, if you just
Yeah.
start breaking down all the Asian players within the country one by one, which one of our Indian players are better than them? So, Parthaloo is one. Then, who are the other guys? The Aussies and Japanese,
You
that two
caught
of David
David
Ogilvy.
Williams.
David Williams, who's better than him? Indian player.
Not many.
Would easily be exported. I mean, if you just base it on that benchmark, like based on what we see in the
Yeah.
country itself, so which of our talent would be desirable for the Asian plus one tag in terms of
Now
what
that you've
comes
put a
into it?
benchmark like that, it's very hard for me to even
But you have to
identify
work
a player.
backwards from that, right? So it's
I mean,
so
Brandon comes
comparing.
to springs to mind right away, and obviously there's some recency bias there, but it's not like he hasn't performed consistently for the last few seasons. But apart from that, very hard because none of them have been consistent. I think consistency is like one of the biggest problems that I see. Like you can show
Availability,
sparks of
consistency,
brilliance, and
change the
that's
game.
yeah.
So the other question on top of that would be, which of the FC Goa players, Indians and foreigners included, would make their way into the Persepolis 11?
That is such a good question that I never asked myself. No
So
wonder you
if
do what you
you,
do.
no, I don't know much about it other than Bakhchodhri
Yeah,
rookie, but
no, that's a good question that I'll never ask. Yeah.
so just
No
reflect on those two games
one.
and tell me. Yeah, so which is one guy who would walk into the Persepolis 11 as a foreigner? And they don't have any foreigners. So
Very hard to gauge that. Maybe fall.
no.
No.
Paul is the Mumbai City FC, no?
Oh yeah, that's true.
Mota, the FC Goa.
Yeah. Yeah, they lost a lot of players as well. Yeah, the best players are gone. I think I can't
But
think
just
of
that
one.
dynamic, if we start to think backwards from this whole
Yeah, that
exception
limits a lot of
level,
things.
and if you look at all these guys who are playing in Asia right now, I mean in Europe right now, the Asians who are playing over there, they have been on the radar since their 15th, 16th birthday. Your Sons, your I think Kagawa, as long as he was around, then the other guy who played
Yeah.
for Manchester United, you see the stories and work on them backwards. These guys had their eyes on them from the time they played in the under 17 World Cups and these different tournaments where they came with their Korean or Japanese club team into Europe to play, and that's where they were picked up. So their story started off much before they made their club debuts and things. And that's where we again need to work backwards in terms from which European clubs are going to realistically come. And I told you, right, like I'd gone to Europe when I was 15, 16 and 17, 18, sorry. And so the first thing I did after my board exams got over, I wrote to every Premier League club, every Bundesliga club and every Dutch club, a 3-page letter saying that I'm the next best thing in Indian football and give me a trial and I would love to come over there and think. Handed, I mean like printouts, I mean postal, no
Scan,
emails back then.
Oh, got it. So you have to post them.
Post them. I think at
Wow.
least 16, 17 clubs replied back.
You
Borussia Dortmund had the courtesy to call up. I wasn't at home. They called up. My mom was there. They're like, we just
better
wanted to
own a
Richard. We were.
BVB jersey, you know, just for
Oh, man.
that.
The lady from Ajax had called up. And then the audacity is like when I had gone to Ajax in 2012, I think Lydia van der Moot, her name was. At the audience, to ask her, do you remember me? Your return man, you had called up and stuff. Obviously, she couldn't give a damn because she must have like made like that call like 6,000 times after that. But like over here, I've got like this whole bunch of letters from Manchester United, from Newcastle, from Olympic Lyonnais, from Middlesbrough, from Leeds, saying that Indians are not on our radar whatsoever. We don't prioritize your country. Some explained it really well. Some just sent her two-page letters. Some had the courtesy, dear Richard, and they actually acknowledged whatever points I'd made in my thing. And I told them I'm the captain of my school team and whatnot. So, I mean, that was again like, so I said, okay, these guys don't want me. I'll go to Denmark and play. I'll go to Czech Republic, thinking that's my benchmark. I mean, so I think at least that growing up, or let's just say the humbling had taken place long time back in terms of this understanding. We aren't really wanted, other than the market strength the Indian superstar can bring to the team and things in
Of
terms
course.
of eyeballs and sales and stuff. But even that isn't attractive enough right now to. They aren't looking at India for even like 15, 16-year-olds and stuff. I really doubt if top Asian superpowers, I mean, top European clubs are curious about, man, where are we going to find the next guy? So each time the foreign player thing comes up, I always work the maths backwards. Okay, only four are allowed, only five are allowed. Is he better than all the locals who would be available there? And then we can talk about the salary. Like, no, but lower divisions, they pay only so much. So would he go? Even if you look
That's a
at.
fair point. That's a fair point. That's such a perspective change in many ways. My mind is blown. I think they should go out as a separate clip on Instagram so that more people's minds are blown. That's crazy. Because like I'm a fan at the end of the day, right? So I never call myself a football expert. I am not one. If people want to call me it just because I make stupid fucking videos, sure. But the reality is I know as much as the next guy. And when I get such perspective changes, I appreciate it. Because we
You get
need that.
trashed
We
for
need
it,
some
so
grounding. What again?
you get trashed for the views, but having these opinions and stuff don't make you whatever, I mean, favorable, and you get tags like I forgot the word even, man, manhoos. So
I
आगे अभी अपना पेलेगा बताएगा ज्यादा ऑल दैट, बट
know.
आई गेस इट्स ओके मैन, इट्स बैक्ड अप बाय फैक्ट्स, सो दैट्स द ओनली
Yeah.
बिलीव.
Yeah, that's what makes your arguments so compelling as well.
Yeah, I don't back up on anything at least. At least I know that I'm not wrong. So
Covered
there's
all
a
your
counter
bases.
argument. Yeah, counter argument always open to it.
Nice. Makes sense. Perfect. Thanks, Richard. This chat was a
Cheers,
long
man.
time in making.
Yeah, 2 years.
2 years at least. Started on LinkedIn. And then I remember I texted you because I was trying to find a board a tactical board and I texted
Oh
you on
yeah, I
WhatsApp.
remember. But I think we sorted that, no? This guy
Yeah,
Raish,
Raish
this
helped me
is,
out.
yeah. I flicked one as well. He had some 5-6 in his house, so I
Yeah.
took one as well the same day.
I was like, who can I? And you turned out to be the perfect guy. I was like, boom, right away. And this
For the
was like
chat
the
with Pradyum, no?
initial.
For the
And
tactical,
exactly, it
whatever,
was
a bit.
used the next
Yeah.
day for
I
Pradyum's, which happened to work quite well,
remember
actually.
seeing that.
Yeah.
Funny.
I should have actually pasted a sticker right next to it, courtesy Richard Hood.
Raish, man, like that's a guy. Anything you need in
Actually.
football, and that's a great resource locally.
Yeah, when I come to Bangalore. If I come to Bangalore.
It'll happen soon enough.
Let's see. Cool. We should do this again, man. I would really
Look forward
appreciate
to
it.
it.
I think there's way too much to talk about in too little time. So it only asks for another edition of it. So we'll do it
I
soon.
look forward to it.
All right.
Cheers.
Cheers, man.
Thanks a
Thank you for
lot.
your time.
Bye.
Take care. Bye, Richard.